Hello, children. Are you ready for some cutting up and kikiing? Are you ready for a gay old time? Well, I hope you are, because now it's time for Hey Queen with your host, Johnny McGovern.
Hey Queen, come on and spill the tea. Hey Queen, it's just a good old fashioned kiki. Hey Queen, we're cutting up with Johnny.
Yes! Hello, my little faggoty children, and welcome to another faggotacious episode of Quonk Quonk with me, your host, Johnny McGovern. Ooh, honey, we got a rock and roll explosion on the show today. Oh, it's going to be very good. Super rock star and super songwriter Justin Tranter is here today. Yeah. Oh, honey, he's rich right now. So rich! But before we bring him out, gotta introduce another special diva rock star. She's the big bird of drag. She's like the Cookie Monster if the Cookie Monster loved fried chicken better than cookies. And she's got more dick than Bert and Ernie put together. It's Miss Lady Regator. Oh. Hey, Queen.
All right, look at you.
Oh, well, what can I say? Wolf, Lady Red.
All right. Wolf. You better go on and give it, hunty.
Wearing my silver fox t-shirt. Oh. I'm saying, wolf. I was waiting for my shot. Waiting for my shot, Lady Red.
Waiting for your shot, I know.
Well, you are giving you're giving everything.
I'm giving, I think we were talking about this in the back.
Yes, yes.
And I just, you know, I have to be honest. I usually give, like, mean first lady of the church.
Oh, yeah, you're right.
I mean? Like, yes. She's like, hello, and welcome to our services. Don't start no shit now.
Oh, I like it. That's good. You know what? The thing is, when you say that, it really does come together. Because if you look at just the different pieces, there's so many different
themes
running through this look. Like,
yes.
Could be Lady Elvis.
Could be
Bride of Frankenstein, who also works at Adana, because you got the hairnet.
Oh, of course.
And then also Jungle Fantasy.
Okay.
And like I said, Big Bird of Drag with the yellow.
Yes, just a mean, pretty whore.
Just a mean, pretty whore.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Of course, we have the beautiful sounds of the returning superstar,
uh-oh,
Mr. Adam Joseph, yay, and the Go to Bed Wigs. Yay! Start talking like this because we're on the quiet storm.
Oh!
Yes. This one goes out to my girlfriend Chi-Chi in Pomona.
Oh my God.
I love you.
That's pretty good.
That's good, Adam. Welcome back from Europe, Adam, of your many trips to Europe.
Thank you, Johnny.
Yes.
It's good to see you and it's great to be back.
Oh. Thank goodness. He finished his tour of the sex clubs of Europe, Lady.
Yes.
Why does everybody have a radio voice but me?
What?
Like you did it, you were sexy old, and then you just say, and now I'm back. And now I'm like, well, hello.
Hi, everyone. So smooth, Lady Red. So smooth.
So weird.
Lady Red, you know you're a smooth motherfucker.
Yeah.
Well, look, we got to get to business,
yes,
honey, because we got a big rock and roll explosion. Justin Tranter is here today. Yes, honey. And he'll be with us right after this very gay break. Hit it, Adam!
Justin Tranter, oh, you know that he's the answer.
Tell him, girl.
Hey, Justin Tranter,
oh,
he's got the song that you need. It's time to spill all the tea on Hey Queen.
Johnny here to let you know about our brand new website, heyqueen.tv. Not only do we have every single episode from every season of Hey Queen, but all of our side shows, Hot Tea, Judge Lady Red, He's Fit, Lady Rad's Corner, Drag Cousins, Whoa Dude, and more. And most importantly, we have our brand new t-shirt shop with brand new t-shirt designs, including Every Boner is a Blessing. Hey, Queen, look at her. Hello, children. Yes, Queen. Plus, tank tops for whores for the summertime. And don't forget, wear your Hey Queen shirts with me and Lady Red on them to show your support for everything Hey Queen. Buy them at heyqueen.tv. We are back. Honey, today's guest is a rock and roll superstar. He was the lead singer for Semi Precious Weapons, opened for Lady Gaga, and now, honey, he is besties with all your favorite pop stars. I'm talking Gwen, Britney, Selena, and all the rest. And here he is, Justin Tranter! Yeah!
Justin Tranter, he got the song you need. It's time to spill all the tea on him.
Yes! Look at him! There he is!
Look at her!
Look at her! Well, hey, Queen.
Hello, darling.
It's been a long time since I've seen you in the flesh.
It's been a long fucking time.
Oh, my God. I think the last time we really ran into each other was, like, at HomoCore. CBGB's.
So probably
2000 and...
Three, four,
maybe,
five,
yeah, something
somewhere.
Like that.
Yeah, a hot minute.
Just a hot minute.
Yeah, a little quick one for just the kids.
Did you bring your own goblet, darling?
Mm-hmm. I came prepared with my own goblet.
You know she's a star, Lady Red, when she brings her own goblet.
Baby, that's a professional.
But now, Justin, I'm just going to pause for a second. Lady Red, lift up what you got.
Wait, I'm trying to open it.
Someone from the audience brought Lady Red a special treat, and which is the way to her heart.
Oh, wow.
Oh, wow.
Oh, my God.
Very nice.
Yeah.
I want to let you know, Justin, she ain't going to share none of those.
That's
so don't ask for one.
That's why I'm showing it to you now. See what you can have.
I haven't had a donut since the 90s.
Well, of course not, darling. You have a lot of couture to fit in. You don't have time for no damn donuts. Oh. Justin, now, like, let's get into what's going on right now. You've been the lead singer of Semi Precious Weapons.
Yes.
You've opened for Gaga. We'll talk about all that. But right now, this second, you and every lady of pop are besties up in the studio, writing emotional songs, channeling your inner lady.
I mean, a couple guys, too.
A couple guys. Yes, true, Justin.
I did Justin Bieber, sorry, so that was, but also emotional.
I mean, let's just, for those that are unaware, every song that you've enjoyed in the last year has been written by Justin.
Thank you.
And your lady partner, Julia?
Yeah, me and Julia did Good For You, Selena. We did Sorry, Bieber. We did Hands To Myself, Selena. And we did a lot of the Gwen stuff together.
Yeah.
And then like the band stuff, like DNCE, Cake By The Ocean, I did alone, or Fall Out Boy, Centuries, I did alone. But like all like the emotional,
all the
super
ones,
pop stuff is with my friend Julia, who's
ones
just
where
the best
it needs,
at all
where a young girl wants to feel like another young girl's help channeling her emotions.
And she's a young girl, yep. And she's a fucking genius. Mm, so it's a good combo.
I mean, is everyone losing their minds? Everywhere you go, you're now like, stop asking me about Britney and Selena!
No, I'm actually fucking thrilled. It's been like so many ups and downs, and my band did amazing stuff, but like in the industry, we were definitely considered like a massive failure.
Really?
We were like dropped from four record labels. I mean, a lot of people lost a lot of money believing in our band.
Mm.
Thank you. but so now that I found my place in the industry and I finally am making music that lots of people are hearing, I'm so fucking grateful. So if anytime people ask me about any of the songs or any of the stars that I'm fortunate enough to work with, I'm thrilled about it. Please. The only thing I don't like is like when people like text me a voice note that they like, I had an idea for a pop song. Oh. Can you please use this? That's a little Because then they might sue you. You know?
Right,
you know,
yeah.
That's the only part of it that I don't like. But, like, talking about it, I love. And it's just so excited and grateful, so.
And also now you can be like, I have to wipe my butt. Let me get a $100 bill out, light it on fire, and blow it in your face. Look at that, I Justin mean, Bieber money's got to be coming in good. Is this jacket really made of silver? Is this a real silver? Because you can buy that.
Platinum, honey.
Platinum. Oh, the checks that are coming in, falling from the sky.
I mean, you're making me very uncomfortable.
Johnny, I don't want to feel weird about it, but hold on, let me wipe my eyes with this $1,000 bill. That's gotta feel good. That's gotta feel good after all these years. I mean, of working
broke as
rock star.
You don't understand. We toured the whole world with Gaga in every arena, getting paid $500 a night.
Yeah, $500 a night.
And when you're traveling with six people, you're broke.
That's like $25 each, no per diem.
Bitch, you have to fly through the sky and pay a crew.
Right.
You came back from that amazing, beautiful, crazy experience. Like 200 G's in the hole. I mean, it was like, so like bad, amazing, but bad and all this shit. So now that I can actually like take my friends to lunch or something, it's just is fucking unbelievable.
To lunch in Japan. It's gotta feel good. It's gotta feel good. Because there's nothing worse than being a famous star and then actually being broke.
Well, I mean, I wouldn't have ever called myself a star. But.
I'm just gonna let you know why I'm looking at your camera. it's not easy. You're traveling with Gaga, then suddenly you're like, I wonder how I'm gonna make rent this month.
And I had like, you know, these amazing three straight band members chasing my big gay dreams with me.
Right.
And being like, you wanna get on stage like naked in 6-inch heels and 10 pounds of makeup? That sounds like a great idea. Right. We're really gonna break right into the mainstream with that. And like, you know, these amazing dudes following me, like, you know, they obviously were living their dreams too, but like, it was my big gay vision.
Right.
And they came back broke as fuck.
Right.
But I hooked everybody up now.
Yes, I bet you did.
The bass player plays in DNCE with Joe Jonas, and then I got the other two guys in Gwen Stefani's band.
So amazing.
Everyone's like looking cute.
Everybody's looking cute, feeling cute, honey. So you got it together.
The pop songs helped the whole band, and it's pretty awesome.
Now you've always been a songwriter. I mean, since you were a kid, and then when you went to Berkeley with Mr. Adam Joseph.
Motherfucker. I haven't known her since she was 12.
We're going way back.
Yeah.
All the way back. You'd always written songs.
Yeah, my degree was in songwriting.
Right.
Whatever the fuck that means.
And you've written them for yourself, but it wasn't until just recently when you started writing for, when you wrote that Centuries for Fall Out Boy, right?
Right.
That was the first big one.
Yeah, I was, so when we were on Epic, the band, which was our third out of four record deals, we never even released a song on Epic, on an album. And so my publisher, luckily, this woman named Katie Vinton, who's just the greatest thing that ever happened to me, was like, so let's be honest, Epic isn't releasing your album ever.
Uh-huh.
Do you want to try to write for other people? And I was like, I want to do anything.
Right.
I'm not going to just sit here and like wait for a song to come out. Because we had toured the Interscope album for 3 years, like it was getting tired. Like, our fans are amazing and supportive, but it's like, we want to see a different show.
We're like, do new material!
it was bad, it was getting bad. So I was like, yeah, please, I want to do anything. So she just started putting me in sessions every single day, and, you know, probably wrote like 200 songs until we got to Century.
And so what was the progression? So Fall Out Boy, and then where was the next,
Selena Gomez, Good For You.
So then Selena, now did you start working with Julia on that project?
Me and Julia had been working together a little bit before that.
Because she's like 12 years old.
She's like negative two.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
she's a zygote.
She's a zygote.
Yeah, she's a thought.
Who's had hits from the womb.
Yeah, she's been, which was funny, so when I met her, she was like 19.
Wow.
And she's been writing in like the Hollywood pop circuit since she was 16.
Whoa.
I have been writing in the pop circuit for like 3 months.
Right.
So even though I'm like 7,000 years old, she was like in it. Like she knew everybody and everything. And we had our first session together. She hid in the closet because she was having a panic attack.
Really?
Uh-huh.
That makes me feel good that even people who are making big hits sometimes hide in the closet and have panic attacks.
um, But we still wrote an amazing song together, and like Calvin Harris and Rita Ora cut it in London like 2 days after we wrote it.
Wow.
Which doesn't happen.
Yeah.
And so we were like, oh, we should write more songs together. And then like within the first 5 songs that we wrote, like 3 or 4 of them were cut like almost immediately. Uh-huh. So we knew that there was something there, mm-hmm. and that we should keep going back. So
I mean, a young girl and a homosexual gentleman of a median age is a perfect combo.
It's pop perfection.
It is pop perfection.
Yeah, like queers in their 30s yep. and young girls, that is pop music.
That is, exactly. Yeah.
And we're the first ones to actually like be the ones making it together. Normally, those are just the people kind of influencing pop music.
You're right.
But we're the first ones to actually do it together, which is kind of fabulous.
And what better duo to show up to help channel the emotions of your favorite pop divas than a homo and his little lady cute
it's
friend.
Kind of the best.
I mean, that's like very, if I was Gwen Stefani, I'd also be like, you know what, it's, yeah, let's do this.
Let's
I
do
feel
this.
Like I can trust you guys.
I mean, she's not really like my little lady cute friend. Like, I'm pretty sure she's murdered multiple people.
Oh, I like
but
it.
But that's what makes her so fabulous.
Yeah.
Like, we call ourselves a good cop, bad cop, and I'm good cop.
Oh, really?
And she's ready to cut everyone and tell them that all their ideas are terrible.
Amazing.
And I'm there to, like, support everyone.
You're
and,
like, yeah, we liked it, but it's not going to work.
Yeah.
She's the boss.
No, but yeah, it's quite a magical combo.
So you guys started really getting serious together on that Selena album?
Yeah, it was like a little bit before that, like a year before that we started writing together.
Right.
But then when we did Good For You, which we just wrote on like a Sunday morning, just me, her, and this producer, Nick Monson. Uh-huh. And Selena heard that and kind of freaked out in a good way.
Yeah.
And recorded it, and we met her through that, and then that kind of like was exactly what Selena was looking for, because she's a very in charge pop star. Like, mm-hmm. she knows exactly what she wants to say and what she wants to sound like and what she wants to do. And so she was like, that's my vision, that's the song. And so from that, she brought us into her project.
And you've got to feel pretty excited that, you know, as a kid who hated pop music, I was like, I don't want to listen to this, I would never. Mm-hmm. And then to have those 2 albums that kind of started to turn you on to pop music,
yep.
Gwen's Love Angel Music Baby,
yep.
and Britney Blackout, and then there you are.
You have done your research.
Yeah, honey, this is Hey Queen. I'm not gonna say hey to you without knowing what's up.
You have done your, yeah, it's true. I hated pop music. Like, if my teenage self knew what I was doing now, my teenage self would be fucking furious. Like, you sell out, you loser, you've ruined everything. Mm. Everyone hates you.
And that's when you write a check and then send it back into time and be like, buy yourself something at Hot Topic, kid. See you in 20.
But then, of course, yeah, Gwen, Love Angel Music Baby, and Britney Blackout. I was like, wait, this shit's actually really awesome.
Yeah.
And then kind of the idea of like, if I can still be the person I want to be and make music that the whole world hears, then that's actually just as subversive, and that's just as political, and that's just as queer.
Yeah, agreed.
Because there are some amazing queer songwriters, obviously, in history, blah, blah, but most of them were in the closet when they started their careers.
Yeah.
And I've been out of the closet since 1994.
Oh, yes, you have. 14 years old,
there
darling.
Go, honey.
Cheers to that.
Cheers
to your little queer ass. God bless you.
Thanks, Mom and Dad.
Now, let's talk about the number one diva world obsession, faggot world obsession.
Oh, God.
Miss Britney Spears. Now, that's like the most amazing. Yeah, that's the kind of clapping you have to give for Britney. So you're working on the top secret B8 or whatever the
nine,
hell it's
B9.
B9. B9, Lady Red, B9.
I'm ready.
We're all ready. So I know you probably, it's probably top secret. You have 9,000 agreements in place where you can't mention anything, but. Are you on a bunch of the album? Because I've seen pictures of you on Instagram. They're just chilling with B.
Chilling with Queen B.
Chilling with Queen B.
Well, did you see on my Instagram where she brought me on stage in Vegas and made me her slave?
I did. That you got to do the old dog walk
it
in
was
Vegas.
Pretty fabulous.
But unlike most of the people, she knew your name and probably made eye contact.
Yeah, it was. She is makes eye contact with everyone.
Okay, good. God bless.
No, yeah, we, you know, you never know what's going to actually be on the album at the end of the day.
Right.
But we definitely got to work with her a bunch of times, and she's just the sweetest. And I think, which I did not, no one ever talks about Brittany as a writer.
Uh-huh.
And she's fucking great.
Really?
Like,
so she
insane,
was co-writing with you
on
these?
Oh, yeah, insane. I mean, a couple we wrote on our own, and that's how we kind of got into it, because we wrote songs before that she liked, and then she recorded those, and then through there wanted to write with us.
Right.
And she's an amazing writer. Like, her concepts, like, were bold and smart and, like, very left of center in a good way. And melodically, she has, like, melodies for days. And I was like, how come no one, of all the Britney things that people talk about, how has no one ever mentioned that this girl can write the fuck out of a song?
Amazing.
It was, like, I was definitely, like, very shocked just because no one talks about it. It was, but I think when your voice is that special and like it's so iconic, there has to be more than just that. You know
totally.
What I mean,
she's a song stylist of the highest order.
No, it is like, I get so, because obviously like, you know, she's not giving you like full Mariah Carey,
uh-huh. and,
but I get so mad when people like want to discredit her as a singer because it's like, well, not all, of course what Mariah does and those kind of singers is unbelievable, but there's room for all different things. And she just interprets the story. Like the minute she opens her mouth, whether she's talking about like fun or sex or she's talking about heartbreak, you feel it immediately.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, we got kicked out of the studio a couple times because we were just too excited while she was singing.
I bet.
Freaking out.
Because I can only imagine, like, she's like, okay, guys, I'm going to start. And then she's like, eh. And you're like,
No, that's literally what, no, like, that's actually exactly what happened.
Yeah, you can
not,
imagine.
Not kidding. It was crazy.
You're like, do it again.
Do it again.
What?
Yeah. it's fucking awesome.
When are you writing the song, be like, let's just start with like a. It's like, why are you making me say what? I'm like, just go in there and do it. Is your voicemail like, hi, you've reached Justin Tranter. This is Brittany. Please leave a message. leave a message at the. Well, let's get back into the part where you're trying to be the latest rock star of them all, giving it to them all.
Yeah.
Because you went to Berkeley, graduated from Berkeley, and you had already done some albums,
solo albums. Yeah.
And then you wanted to form a group called Precious. And your straight band members were like, you know what? We're going to do your faggoty shit, but let's add Semi and Weapons in there and we can do it.
That's kind of how it went.
Right.
But instead of my band members, it was my dad saying that.
Oh, your dad?
He was like, listen, I think it's Precious is great and all, but I think you can do something more unique and more universal. And so even though the band couldn't have been further from universal.
But, right.
Yeah, so I started that band, and just like I called the three guys in my band, and I said, I'm starting a band called Same Press Weapons. You're in it. And they said yes. And we started making music and started playing shows.
And that was in New York?
In New York. You
knew each other from school?
We all met in Berkeley.
Okay.
So the bass player and I were roommates freshman year of college, just like put together accidentally. Yeah. And so started the band. It was kind of, because I did like the solo stuff, which was like very dramatic and very political and queer and emotional. And like when I moved to New York, I thought it was gonna be like the Warhol times that I fantasized about.
Yeah.
And then I realized like everyone wanted to be in Sex and the City, not in Blondie.
Right.
So it's a little, it was a little depressing.
Right.
I love Sex and the City, I just didn't wanna live there.
Right, yeah.
Yeah.
You didn't make a band called Semi Charlotte Weapons.
However, it probably would have been a lot
that's
more
amazing.
Successful.
Semi Charlotte Weapons is incredible.
We'll start it.
That's good.
Yeah. So just wanted to like, create that over-the-top, gender-bending punk situation.
Right.
So did that.
And that started to really, I mean, you started to really already get a fan base from the beginning of that whole thing.
It went pretty quick in New York. It was, MySpace was very helpful.
God bless MySpace.
God bless MySpace.
Yeah.
God bless Jeffree Star putting us in his top friends.
Oh, that definitely helped.
Because then every queer kid who could get to a show came.
Wow.
Probably just hoping to see him there, not to hear the band.
Didn't matter, whatever
yeah.
it took.
And so that kind of like, and then like we were voted best band by the Village Voice readers poll.
Uh-huh.
But the Village Voice never acknowledged our existence, but the readers voted.
Really?
Because we weren't like hipster.
Uh-huh.
You know, like that was the era of like, you can only stare at your shoes and play your instruments poorly.
How boring.
To be like considered good.
Right.
So no one, but the people.
The people
if
were
you
behind
will.
You.
Were behind us. Mm-hmm. And so then from there, the band got progressively more ridiculous. I started wearing less clothing and more makeup.
Yes, I remember it very well. I mean, during that growing period when you had Lady Gaga open for you, when it's good old Stephanie, let's get old Steph to do it. Let's throw her a bone.
The reason, the way we heard of her is that she went to a meeting at Columbia, and Columbia at the time was really trying to sign us. Some A&Rs there were, but the boss man said, hell no. There's guitar solos and...
And faggotry. Yeah, we don't know what to do with this.
But they said, we had this girl, Lady Gaga, came in to meet with us today. We don't think we're going to sign her. But she said that her favorite band in the world is Semi Precious Weapons.
Wow.
And I think it would be like a good fit if you ever need an opener. Uh-huh. Because she's very musical, but it's very over the top. And like same thing with us, even though the music's different.
Yeah.
It's like music school losers who have lost their minds. So we were like, checked her out on MySpace, and she had a song up there called Dirty Ice Cream.
I don't think I've ever heard Dirty Ice
Cream.
It's
fabulous.
That sounds good.
And so we had her open for us, and she was amazing and wasted, and she left one shoe and her keyboard stand at the club.
I'm glad to know she's keeping it Gaga style.
And then so her and her mom came to retrieve her shoe and keyboard stand from our loft in Greenpoint.
Amazing.
And then she became the biggest star in the world.
Then somehow, right in the middle, she became the number one star of the world.
Like, in the whole world. Like,
yeah.
Unbelievable.
So let's talk about that record deal progression. So you're starting to get interest from A&R people.
Yeah.
You're obviously doing something very queer, very out there.
Yeah.
What was that experience like, dealing with all the suits and the people being like, well, we're going to get this for radio? And-
It was interesting because they would all, around 2007, so even before all the Gaga stuff happened, there was like a whole swarm.
Right.
So Interscope even came then, before they actually signed us 2 years later. Virgin, Columbia, like a whole storm of everyone showing up. And then they all went away. Uh-huh. No one actually signed us.
Right.
And then the guy from Columbia moved to Razor and Tie, which is a smaller label out of New York, famous for Kids Bop.
Yeah, God bless Kids Bop.
They've now done, Kids Bop has done multiple of my songs, so it's like a full circle moment.
I mean, it's all happening.
So we were on Razor and Tie for like a hot minute.
Uh-huh.
And nothing really happened, and so they let us go, and then we signed to Interscope, and Interscope was amazing with us. They were like, do whatever you want, we believe in you, Gaga believes in you, go.
Wow.
Because that was when like that whole thing was going when she was the biggest.
So she was huge, and so Jimmy Iovine was like, come on down and we'll do the deal and we'll get it together, kids.
Just be
gay. She likes you. It's faggots are hot. Go for it. Thanks to Gaga, faggots are hot. You can wear your shoes.
The problem is that you women being faggots is hot.
Yes, that
faggots
is.
Faggots can't be
faggots.
Isn't
that always the problem? Thank you, sound effects. Yes, ladies are always allowed to be the biggest faggots.
Yeah. So we learned that real quick. But Interscope let us make the album we wanted.
Right.
They did give us some tour support for like the first couple months of the Gaga tour, but then pulled that and dropped us, and we stayed on the tour and lost all this amazing money. And
wow.
But it was a crazy, crazy experience playing to kids all over the fucking world.
Yeah, that must have really been amazing when Gaga told them you'd be opening for them, whether they liked it or not.
It's the most punk thing ever.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah,
and you
really cool.
opened yourself to a whole new audience, for sure.
It was crazy. However, all of our rock fans were pretty mad at us.
Really?
So you win some, you lose some.
Yeah, what are you going to do? You're like, we're on tour with Lady Gaga, man. Like, just line up, man. Get a bitch live. Get a bitch live. So in the middle of this great success, you get dropped by your record label.
Four record labels.
So you get from one, you try another. That's not working out. Try another. Mm-hmm. That's not working out.
I mean,
finally, L.A. Reid was like, sure, homo, we'll do it. And then he was like, nah.
No. Yeah, kind of. That's kind of what happened. Tricky Stewart, producer, signed us to him. And then through him, he was working at Epic and signed us there. He believed in us more than anybody, and which was amazing because it's this, you know, hip hop,
yeah, he's
pop
like a,
producer.
Totally.
Being like, no, this band is amazing and this guy writes amazing songs. That was his main thing, was like, these songs are fucking great. Someone has to do something.
Yeah.
So he really, really believed in us and did everything that he could to like make us the biggest band in the world. The problem is I just still think we are in a place where the world is not ready for a gay star who, I mean, our show was very sexual and the songs are very sexual and I'm not gonna change that. So even when the sound got a little more pop, because that's what I was getting into, lyrically it was still very like sexual and gay.
That's what I love about you, Justin. You didn't let them fuck with your lyrics.
No, and so, you're just the best. You're just the best. So I think the world's just still not ready for that. You know,
It's still a long way to climb. Like you said, the world's ready for lady faggots.
Yeah.
Like ladies who are doing faggoty shit and snapping and all the rest.
Yeah.
But when it's a real gay man doing it, even gay guys have difficulty with that kind of stuff.
I think it's the biggest problem we're facing is that our own community won't accept gay men being sexual and feminine unless they're in drag.
Either a drag queen or a porn star. And then if you're not either one of those, then it's like, I don't know.
Yeah.
I'd rather go see Kathy Griffin. Sad but true.
So I think we're in a very weird place. I think it has to start with us. If we don't accept our own community being sexual and artistic all at the same time, and possibly feminine, God forbid.
Oh, God.
God forbid.
If you're not all the way a woman, it's not real. That's the problem.
Until we accept that, how the fuck are we going to get mad that, like, more huge corporations aren't investing in queer movies that are sexual and queer pop stars that are sexual? Like, how, if we don't accept it, how are we going to get mad that these straight corporations aren't investing in it? And I think for us, we actually, even though it didn't happen for the band, we had a lot of people really try. And when you can't even get, for the most part, gay men to show up to your show.
Yeah.
You know, our fan base was like mainly like women and guys, like straight guys that love guitar solos.
Yeah.
So, you know, of course, if you're an executive, like, wait, we can't even get the gay community to come see this band. Stop spending money.
Right, like, exactly. Fuck? That's the thing. Like, black movies and black shows can get black audiences. We have a big problem, gay men coming to see other gay men, unless, you said, like, they're dressed as women or they're porn stars.
Yeah, and it's obviously a deep issue of shame and internalized homophobia.
Yep.
And it makes me very sad. And we have to change it first. And if we don't fucking change it, then how do we expect everyone else to?
Well said, Justin. Cheers to that. Justin, I think you're amazing.
Well, thank you.
I'm happy that you're rich as fuck right now, that you're writing songs for all the stars, and I really love that you are just throwing your little subversive queer stuff into these huge pop music things. That's what's really exciting. It makes me like, good old Justin, just still fagging it up, no matter what.
Well, what's even cool, thank you, first of all, but what's even cooler is that, like, you know, my main writing partner is a straight woman.
Yeah.
And she is all for it. All these amazing pop stars that I work with are all for it. And I can't believe that it's happening. You know, they're all, women should be strong. Men can be vulnerable.
Yeah,
we should have fabulousness. And if we're gonna be inspired by the gay community, why not have a fucking gay person a part of the process?
There you go.
And it's amazing.
Well, honey, you have turned it so fiercely that you have snatched your trophy already. Yes! Take a trophy.
Ooh, she's hefty.
She's heavy.
Ooh.
And honey, I hope you like dick, cause we got your lap dance! Yay! Do it! Don't be shy, Justin! Your music is sexual, and so are you!
Yes! Open it up!
Now we have to sing about dick and boo!
Touch it! Taste it! Feel it!
Don't be shy, girl!
Rub it!
Selena wants you!
Oh, yeah! Can my friend take the lap dance?
Lady Red, give me some of that black lady's prayer. Now, you don't want, don't go anywhere because Justin's gonna be on the after show playing Look at Her. And you know we got some serious hugs to look at. Thank you, Lady Red. Thank you, Adam. We'll see you next time on Hugwong.